Hey, my name is Craig King, and I am a natural food chef here in Boulder, Colorado. And as a chef, I've worked long and hard to make sure that whatever I end up putting on someone's plate has not exploited anything in the process. And I don't think I'm really special for that. I think it's just the way it should be. It's also a challenge to other chefs to step up to the plate and literally step up to the plate and take it up another level, because our future and our environment depends upon all of us learning how to vote with our consumer dollar. What we do with it matters very much. And every time you make a vote with your dollar, you're saying yes to something and no to something else. We're gonna travel the country and highlight all the beautiful people who are doing the right thing and helping us eat right now. And we're also going to highlight some of the ongoing daily disasters that are creating such toxic and ill effects in our food world. So, hope you enjoy the tour.
They devised, and I say they, I mean the food manufacturers, devised a way of using chemicals to enhance the taste of food. They are known as chemical taste enhancers. Chemical taste enhancers are made from amino acids. Now, amino acids are the building blocks of protein, and they're also used in the brain as neurotransmitters. So a chemical taste enhancer is very, very toxic to the brain. It's actually a neuroexcitotoxin. So in order to make food taste good, once you've taken the nutrients out, food manufacturers have come up with a way of chemically enhancing taste. And they do it through using these neuroexcitotoxins. So if when you eat foods that have chemical taste enhancers in them, what's happening is you're destroying the brain cells in the hypothalamus that is actually in charge of regulating all kinds of activities that happen in your body.
The temperature is over 86 degrees. The methanol in aspartame is converted to formaldehyde, which that typically happens in a cup of coffee. Formaldehyde is in the same category of top poisons as cyanide and arsenic. Aspartame has brought more complaints to the FDA than any other food additive. There have been over 10,000 complaints, and they stopped counting 2 years ago.
I think what happens is that, you know, we've gotten to a place where when you eat something, it's not like you have a direct reaction that you instantly get sick or that you instantly have a mental problem. It's an accumulation of eating something over and over again.
You don't just get cancer when you're 50. Those cancer cells are turned on at a young age, and then they just grow and grow and grow and grow. And then when you're 50, you're like, oh, I have cancer. How'd that happen?
Our bodies are not designed to be built from fake anti-food, from plastic food.
I think it came home to me particularly clearly when I suddenly realized I was forbidding my own children to drink Coca-Cola, and then I went to work and I managed, you know, $1 billion budget to try and drive people to drink more Coca-Cola.
I suddenly realized that if I was worried about my own family, I had to worry about all the families I was selling to or marketing to.
So that dichotomy, that violent hypocrisy in a way, led me to say, okay, I've got to change and I've got to leave and I can't do this kind of work anymore. I'm looking at business ideas and business constructs that are about reparation, because for a wide variety of reasons, I mean, we've damaged the earth so badly, we've created nutritional systems that are just horrendous. So what can I do? What small, socially responsible, nutritionally responsible business can we launch and begin to talk about them as examples, as models that can be duplicated in a wide variety?
Focus on the solutions, not the problems. Because you already know what the problem is. That's there. And then just focus on the solution, because what you focus on expands. The successes that keep me going, I think about 2 years ago, the Humane Society of the United States started a cage-free campaign with colleges and universities. They reached out to various colleges and universities and asked them, all of the eggs you purchase, please get them from hens that aren't kept in battery cages. We have 300 colleges and universities that have signed up in the past couple of years. And that's a clear recognition of, we don't want to endorse cruelty. You can go to a grocery store now and go on the freezer section, and whether it's Amy's or Garden Burger or Tofurky, there's an array of foods now for people who want to eat a plant-based diet. Well, the organic food is a little bit more expensive. It's far less expensive, though, than multiple doctor bills. So an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. So you're either going to spend it in this column or that column.
When I go out, say, in the garden and put my hands in the soil and see the plants that grow, to me, that's, everything just kind of relaxes and goes into the soil.
Food is at the very base of who we are as these miracle beings. We are not machines. We can simply choose to eat organic food.
If you think you're too small to make a difference, you've never slept with a mosquito.
I have a little boy named CJ who is 12 years old, who at 3 years old was diagnosed with autism. And that created a whole different world for everybody who loved us. And that's kind of where my world with understanding food and how it worked and how I could use it in a way other than just to fill us up. We used it to heal ourselves. I guess I learned a lot about what green food really does to you, and it does really have nutrients. And you need to have greens with proteins. And I found that when I put those two things together, it created a whole different world for CJ.
Bye, CJ. Bye, Nolan.
And none of us had any idea that autism would actually create a healing for the whole family.
Be an irritant. Be a wise consumer, because the manufacturers mostly will only listen to consumer revolt. And the more we continue to vote for what we think is the right thing, the more what we consider the wrong thing will start to fade away.